actually the keyboard industry is trying to eliminate. Conspire, conspiracy.
So thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today is Tuesday, June 7th. Is the study session meeting for the Gateway Board of School Directors. If we could all please rise to the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Byrne.
Here.
Mrs. Cerucci.
Here.
Mr. Lapsevich.
Here.
Mr. Nola.
Here.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Here.
Mr. Ritter.
John Ritter's here.
That's way too loud.
Mr. Steubenbord.
Here.
Mrs. Warren.
Here.
And Mr. Williams.
Here.
Thank you. We will now take comments from residents on agenda items and agenda items only. We have four who have signed up. We're going to start with a more important item. Mr. Sakunas, go ahead.
Hello, my name is Mr. Sakunas. I teach honors robotics at Gateway High School. I'm here to thank the school board, the superintendent, Mr. Short, and a few others for Team Slambox's success at the Underwater Robotics Championship, the National Sea Perch Challenge, on Saturday, May 21st at Louisiana State University. More than 195 teams maneuvered their hand-built, remotely operated ROVs through underwater obstacle course and orbs challenge at the LSU Natatorium in Baton Rouge. By participating in Sea Perch, our students learned about marine engineering, naval design. It also introduced them to STEM education, but also teaches them about communication and teamwork. The Sea Perch program sparked the interest of our students to go into careers like engineering and STEM. It gives them skills for presentations, and it gets them working together as teams with other students. Through the Honors Robotics class, computer, robotics club, and robotics club, more than 40 Gateway High School students were exposed to Sea Perch this year. With the success of Team Slambot, I hope to increase the interest in next school year. Sam Mashenko, Luke DePalma, Asher Pascalinqua, and Mitch Woolforth, Team Slambot, represented Gateway High School. This group of young men did a great job on their poster board, finishing 11th, and we passed out a copy of their poster board. It completed the obstacle course in a blazing time of 54 seconds, good enough for fifth place, and finished second in the orb challenge, collecting the max score of 80 points in 8 minutes and 44 seconds. Team Slambot finished third overall out of 75 competing high school teams from across the country, plus Australia, the Cayman Islands, and the U.S. Virgin Islands. Gateway School Board, thank you for your support and giving the students the opportunity to participate in the National Sea Perch Challenge. What a great experience. We would also like to thank Mr. Bob Brown, Mr. Dave Hebelchek, and Mr. Randy Rivesti for finding us time to practice and test the ROV in the high school pool. And believe me, we spent probably over 20 hours in the pool testing. Thank you to Gateway teachers Lauren DiMaria, Don Nicolaza, Dr. Klinger, Tracy Riccardi, Katie Marks, Colleen Tortorella, Dr. Matt Kohler, Henry Periello for reviewing, critiquing, and working with the team and helping make their poster board great. So thank you.
If I can just also add that the countless hours that Mr. Sakunas has put into the program and with the kids. Matt, I've known you for years, and I know the commitment you have to education and the communities here in Monroeville and Pickering, and I personally thank you for all of that.
Thank you.
On behalf of the school board, I just want to say congratulations. It was quite the decision to send you guys down to LSU, and we're definitely glad that we did, and you guys obviously represent us well. Third place out of 75 teams is amazing. And Emily, if you're looking for a story, you might want to grab their email address.
Yeah.
I have the title of a story. Gateway robot team brings home Stanley Cup. Okay? Pretty good. Matt, great job. Team, awesome job. Great job.
It was an honor for me to support Jens, and I'm hoping you come back next year. If you need a ticket to go somewhere, just give me a call.
Thank you.
All right, we will now open it up to comments from residents on agenda items. We have four who have signed up in advance. We will start with Dave Palermo. You can just state your name and address for us, Dave.
Okay, Dave Palermo, 173 Shackelford Drive, Monroeville, Pennsylvania. Okay, I was asked here to come and address the questions dealing with the armed police officers in the schools now. I'm pretty sure a lot of people know my reputation and my resume. I could hit it real quick. Police officer, I started my career in 1978 with East Pittsburgh Police. Then I came to Monroeville. Served 28 years, finishing up as lieutenant of training and patrol. Later on, then I went to Westmoreland Community College, where basically the same thing you're proposing I attempted to do at Westmoreland Community College. They wanted to transfer from security to police. Did that for a while, and then Pitcairn offered me their chief of police position. So I went down there for approximately 2 years. And then after that, I decided just to teach. I still continue to teach out of the police academy. Also, just recently, I was up UPMC East as the supervisor of police and security. Again, same type of situation as George could address to. And also the same issues, armed versus unarmed. Currently, within the past month, I accepted a position with a company called Command Excellence. You could probably look it up on your laptops. We go around a group of instructors and we talk to corporations. Just recently, back in April, Milan Labs, where Milan Labs brought in all their security managers from across the country, where we put on a presentation on active shooters and what occurs during that time and how to protect themselves and also how the staff could protect themselves in these type of situations. Our recommendations all the time is, like during that last meeting, it was true. Most active shooting is done within 5 to 8 minutes. The injuries and the killing are done. Officers respond within 2 to 3 minutes of dispatch. I could do a presentation, but I'm not sure how powerful it would be at this point, where we have a shot being fired. And we go through when people decide to, should we call 911? What was that? There's about a minute or two of denial. And at that point in time, you add now 2-3 minutes before even the dispatch, before somebody calls 911. Then there's about a minute or 2 minutes where the dispatcher is trying to get information. Due to the fact, especially in a school, say the high school, for example, how big the high school is, where's the shooter at, how many, things like that. So you add that on. By the time the officers get here, 9 times out of 10, it's done. The reason for my opinion, reason that officers should be in the schools, trained officers in our techniques, is the quicker the intervention. Try to intervene within 1 to 2 minutes. And quite frankly, if the officers are out of school or in different parts of the building, like the SROs, if they're up here at the high school, and God forbid something happens at Evergreen, now how are they going to get there? Like I said, there's that time limit. And if you want me to, I could do a demonstration. Should I do it? Does this amplify?
It's for the TV.
Oh, okay. So you want to hear it here?
If you put it to the microphone.
If I put it to the speaker,
yeah,
to the microphone. Might even sound like this. You're in this room talking right now, and you don't even know. Say, what is that? I don't know. What do you think? You don't hear any screaming, and it's going to go up and down hallways. We're already into only a minute and a half, and every shot is potential somebody being injured, somebody dying. If we go through this whole think how long it takes. And that's why, in my opinion, you should have officers armed. As far as, I mean, I start off with, pardon my French, it sucks that now in today's society we have to think about this. But we're going to be remiss if we don't. Well, I heard one comment tonight that, why our school? There's no incidents happening at our school. Good thing. We hope not to. Franklin Regional said the same thing. They have no incident at their school. And we see what happened. Nobody's immune. You know, there's a myriad of reasons. I heard one was maybe if we curtail the drug activity. Studies have shown most of these school shootings, drugs are not the root. It's usually mental illness. An irate parent or a student that has something. Columbine, for example. Yeah. I mean, right after Columbine, Bill remembers. We did girls up to school right after that. We actually tried to get to school before.
April 20th, 1999, Columbine. Not that that changed everything.
Right. Even our tactics, police tactics up at that point was surround and wait for SWAT. SWAT on average is an hour to get on scene before they even get up and operational. That's what happened in Columbine by the time they came in. And even after that, it evolved from waiting for teams of four or five officers, and now it's first officer on scene, first officer in. Hence why I said, you know, the whole purpose, again, we're not going to prevent all the deaths or injuries. I mean, somebody walks in, you know, say a prayer for the person that first greets them, like Western Psych, that receptionist in the middle, and that intern that was walking through the hall. But it was the University of Police officer who came around the corner armed. Their response time was 2-3 minutes due to the fact it was a change of shifts and their police station was right next to Western Psych. So they were able to go right over and he ended it. The whole purpose of the officer is to end the situation as quickly as possible. By the very least, delay him, hurt him until by some time till the rest of the officers get there to try to end the situation. And again, I sympathize with you people. You know, there's a lot of budgets, a lot of politics, and again, a lot of comments going back and forth. So, I mean, if you have any questions right now, that'd probably be the best way for me to answer them right now. If anything comes up later.
What is the name of your business again?
Command Excellence. John Sakoian, he's retired Upper St. Clair Lieutenant. He started a company a couple of years ago. You go to their website, you can see all the facilities that they go through this. There's other companies out there too that teach it. Like I said, I've been doing the active shooting thing ever since Columbine. At one time, we even had the Marine Corps up here going through almost the exact same thing. I still remember when we didn't tell nobody about that one. We kept the secret because of the Marines. It was right at North for Sales Reserve. We're about to go back into Iraq. They were there at the invasion. And the Marine captain seen what we were doing, and he said, I want my men to have that training. So we said, okay, we arranged it. And I still remember I was standing here with the janitorial staff up at the cafeteria entrance. They're like, what's going on? And we just let them know that it was like police. I said, oh, we're just doing some training. Just then, the Marines were coming in, big buses, all smoked out windows, and the janitor supervisor's looking at Marines fully dressed, helmet, gear, everything coming off. He looked at me and I said, it's a coup, first the school, then the municipality. And I am king.
But, any other questions for Dave?
I just want to say I've been a Navy for 44 years. I know I'm dating myself, but it's been that long.
Oh, yeah, you babysat me when I was in kindergarten.
Oh, yeah. Everything that they've done. So, Dave, thank you for everything. I really appreciate and for.
Oh, like I said, I thank you for the opportunity coming up and agreeing, addressing the situation. Like I said, everybody knows my numbers. If you have any individual questions, let me know. Like I said, it is a big responsibility. Some of the proposals I suggest
like I did up to college. Also, when as far as the impact of the officers being in uniform, some people, and quite frankly, the uniforms are designed to be intimidating. Out in the street, that's the way we have to operate. And a lot of times we diffuse those situations. But in a school, especially like in an elementary school or kindergarten, the officers we did with the DARE officers in the summertime, they went in soft uniforms, basically a polo shirt like this with the police emblem. And sometimes if they're in the parks, they wore shorts, very easy approachable, but they had the tools of the trade with them to stop something if it occurred. And that's the main thing that we were looking at. And also there's one part that's not quantitative. Once it gets out that there's officers here that are trained to take care of business, that might in effect deter. There's no way to measure it though. It's the same as when we tie up the police academy, a marked patrol car going by, going through a neighborhood. There's no way to quantify if they stop something. If somebody came out and seen that patrolman there and that car going by, and they decide to change their minds, okay, we're not going to do something. They're in the area, we're not going to do it. So that's a part. Hopefully, if you do implement this, nothing happens. I pray to God nothing happens, because no matter what, it's going to be a tragic day. But the whole thing is to limit the souls that go that day.
Thank you very much, David.
Thank you.
Next up we have signed up is George Pulner. George, if you could just state your name and address, please.
Sure. George Polnar, 871 Patton Street, Monroeville. Lifelong resident, Gateway grad. Go Gators. Thank you for the opportunity for me to come up here this evening. There's not a whole lot to add to what Dave said. Oh, some background. Gateway grad, joined Monroeville Police Department in 1979. Got promoted through the ranks, and when I retired after 13 years as chief in 2010. I spent the last 13 years of my career as chief. During that time, I am an adjunct faculty professor at Community College of Allegheny County and also Point Park University. After retirement, about 2 years, I headed up security at UPMC East. Actually, I was there 6 months before the hospital opened, was assigned to build a security team, help implement the security systems, cameras, the locks, the badging system, et cetera. Brought in one of my detectives, who would have been supervisor. And when I left, he moved up and actually hired Dave to the hospital. So we kind of go full circle. When Dave was playing the sounds, and he's so right, there was some discrepancy, 2 minutes to 3 minutes, 5 to 8 minutes. I've always been taught 3 to 8 minutes until the situation's over. I recall my first day at the staff meeting at the hospital, and the president asked me to make a presentation. And as I was walking up to the microphone, I said, "Mr. President, shall I be politically correct or totally honest?" He said, "Be honest." I said, "People are going to die. If somebody has a mindset and they come into your facility and they're armed, they have a plan, somebody's going to die. How to counter that? Intelligence. But you always have to deal with the person that we call the lone wolf, Dylan Klebold, and the other name escapes me, Columbine.
Harris.
It was April 20th, 1999. Mm-hmm. Two lone wolves. They had a plan. Alex Reibel, Forbes Regional, or Franklin Regional. Lone wolf. He had a plan. Kept him to himself. If he doesn't tell anybody, nobody knows. And because of HIPAA regulations and all kinds of other laws that we have to deal with, you know, I've met many people in my career, I'm sure Dave has as well, there's something not quite right about this person. I recall one of the guidance counselors one day telling me, years ago, she says, "You watch this kid, you're gonna see him again." And we did. I don't wanna mention any names, but Mr. Short mentioned a name to us one time. "You're gonna see him again." He was voted most likely to be on the roof as a cop killer. We've had incidents with them. It's the ones that don't say anything, the ones that keep it bottled up inside for myriad reasons. Why are they gonna do this? And they just go about planning, plotting, getting everything in place. And then at some point something clicks in their mind, today's the day. Or they plan it ahead of time. I hear rumors that the Franklin Regional situation was carried out on, I think, Dylan Klebold's birthday.
It was.
Carried out what?
Carried out on Dylan Klebold's birthday, the Columbine.
Right.
The day after Columbine, I think Dr. Demensik was the superintendent.
Mm-hmm.
Called him, I said, hey, Doc, uniforms. Make them all wear uniforms. Well, we knew that wasn't going to happen, but one thought. When Dave played the audio, you hear the sound. How many can identify a gunshot from firecrackers? Sometimes it's very difficult. Multiple shots. Maybe somebody sets off a string of firecrackers. You don't know. There's a website, dhs.gov /critical, talks about active shooters. And they play out a scenario. You can go on YouTube. There are a number of scenarios played out on YouTube to watch as well. And you see how this evolves. And like Dave said, it happens. Somebody comes in with a gun. They take the first person out they see going toward their target. Maybe that was their target. Maybe that was an impediment to get to their target. By the time you realize, then you've got to call the 911. 911 goes down to Allegheny County. They elicit information. There's time. Then they've got to notify Monroeville. They've got to elicit information. There's time. The time is building. Almost to the end of the entire scenario. Then once they get the cars dispatched, unfortunately, we were able to put in place a number of years back a good computer system in the cars. That is, that call is being typed in, it's coming up on the screen to the officers. And they can see what's about to happen. So they're headed toward that area before it's dispatched. That's a time saver, but there's still time involved. The time grows. The situation is evolving. Maybe they are armed. Maybe they've got places in the building planted with explosives. They've done their homework. Maybe it's just somebody that's coming in that they've had a beef with their ex-wife, and she's the one that's going to go down. We don't know. We don't know until after the fact. And even after the fact, so many questions are left unanswered because the people involved are dead. And Mr. President, I said, politically correct or brutally honest? Be honest. People are going to die. Uniforms. As Dave mentioned, when I was at the hospital and before we hired anybody, there was a big discussion between myself, my boss, and the president. Uniforms versus non-uniforms. They said, well, in a hospital setting, you're going to intimidate people with uniforms. I said, what you don't understand is they're the ones we want to intimidate, the bad guys. And like Dave said also, I keep referring back to what he said because he's spot on. You can't measure what you've prevented. In your heart, you may know it, but you can't put a number to it. So if you've got uniformed, trained police officers, and I have to agree with Corporal Kandrak and Officer Morenci, their participation is invaluable. Because I recall when I was still working, we got information through those officers. Well, Officer Morenci wasn't involved at the time. Things we wouldn't have known. We had word through the grapevine because they contacted one of our SROs. There was going to be a gun brought to one of our dances. We wouldn't have known that, but he said something to somebody. The old adage, if you see something, say something. We need to know. We're not the bad guy. It's our job. Tell us. Somebody told him, the officer. He came to the dance, went to the men's room. The officer followed him right in, saved a tragedy. Was he going to hurt anybody? Who knows? But nobody got hurt, so we know that was prevented. I vowed that I wasn't going to say this, but there is another adage that's often said. The only way to counter a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. We've been shooting in shopping malls out in Midwest. If an individual had not been armed, legally, licensed to carry, there probably would have been more deaths. This person had a lot of ammunition on them. They started shooting them. So do we want to intimidate the kids? No. And that's not the intent, I'm sure, of what you're looking to do. I think you want them to be out there. Just because we have an armed guy in the elementary school, we used to do the DARE program. And I'm proud to say I'm a Pennsylvania Mason. and we funded the DARE program for many, many years. Unfortunately, because of studies, the DARE program just outlived its usefulness. I was glad toward the end we were able to fund it into the junior high school instead of just the elementary schools. Walt Lineski, our retired chief, was our first DARE officer. They called him Officer Shiny Shoes. He was in full uniform in the elementary schools daily. He built a rapport. And that's what these guys, I'm sure, would do if you have a uniformed officer at Evergreen or any of the other elementary schools. They're going to learn to trust these officers. And I think it's going to be a tremendous benefit. And granted, you know, we see so many kids nowadays that are become issues to us. And somebody mentioned earlier it takes a village to raise a student. It takes a family to raise a student. It takes a church. And maybe I'm going to get, you know, the ACLU will contact me about this. But, you know, I'm not trying to mix church and state. But you need to have some basis, some moral ground, something to, these kids have to grow from. And I'm not criticizing the parents that have to, both parents have to work or a single parent has to work. Television raises them. How do you entice a kid to come to McDonald's to work for minimum wage when you can make more in a weekend selling drugs than you can in a year at McDonald's at minimum wage? I mean, that's tough. It's a tough nut to crack. But if they see that law enforcement is not the bad guy, and you can be successful, and they learn to trust the officers, intelligence is the key to our doing our jobs well. There was a question that somebody had mentioned to me once about, they're afraid somebody would pull a gun on an elementary child. Well, I would hope that wouldn't happen. And if it did happen, there better be a doggone good reason why. Because a six-year-old will kill you as dead as a 40-year-old if they're armed properly. There was an incident that happened in Ramsey a couple years ago. Kid found a gun in his backpack, and he did the right thing. And I'm glad that the board at the time acquiesced and realized he did the right thing. So, I mean, common sense prevails in some of these situations, too. And law enforcement officers have to have a lot of common sense. We have a lot of autonomy in our job. We have to make a lot of decisions. We don't have a lot of supervision a lot of times. You roll into work after roll call, if you even had roll call. You're on the shift for 8 hours. You're out on the road for 6-7 hours by yourself. So we had to put trust in those individuals. And anybody that you would put in the schools armed, hopefully they would be properly vetted. There would be trust in these individuals. And they would have built a rapport with the people. And again, like Dave said, you can't gauge or measure what you prevented. But once the word gets out that we have armed people in the schools, sometimes that's going to be a deterrent. Is it going to stop their action if they want to hurt another student? No, maybe they'll wait till school's out. But at least it didn't happen during our time. And we may have gotten information that we could then intervene and prevent something from happening after school hours.
Thank you, George.
Any questions?
No, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Quickly, yeah.
Yeah, real quick. Just what George mentioned, as far as the SROs, and I think him and I are in agreement, and I said this before, my suggestion is to keep them.
Due to the fact they offer infrastructure, which we don't have. This is going to be a young force. I'm not sure how far you want to take this, but little things that they could bring. Actually, right off the bat, Mark, if something happens, key of the button, he could bring resources here that is unimaginable that a single school police officer does not have. He could bring in detectives, and we're not talking about the active shooter part, just the day-to-day operations, an assault, things like that, investigations, which your SRO, your school officers, I don't perceive will be capable of doing that for years to come, as far as if you want to give them that responsibility due to the fact my suggestion was there on the school officer's primary thing is to take care of the children just in case the active shooter comes. But if you start adding to investigations, things like that, you're taking them off property, you're taking their attention away from what's happening at that school at that time. The other thing, just off the top of my head, as far as infrastructure, if an irate parent comes in and that officer has to make an arrest, where's that officer, that school officer, going to take them? Structure's already there. Monroe will to pick them up, take them to the lockup. Unless you're willing to go with the visual of having a lockup in one of the schools. Yeah, these are things that nobody really thinks of, because when we did it, it's out of sight. But if you got an irate parent who's screaming, hollering, disturbing, I think George remembers one. We had one guy down in the cell in the council chamber. Bruce might remember. I think, I forget what the manager was, sent down. I was the shift's commander at the time. Can you get that guy and shut him up? Because he was disrupting the whole thing. And he was just banging around. These are things you probably do not want on the school. Again, there's a lot of stuff, and including training. The SROs go through the same police training, and I could envision that the school officers, especially with law enforcement background, Act 120, we just simply enroll it with them. Mutual cooperation back and forth. So, again, I don't think this program could work without them.
Thank you, Dave. Next up, we have Glenn.
Dave, you need to be in bed early.
But if you could just state your name and address, please.
My name is Glenn Raymer. My address is 171 Monticello Drive, right here in Monroeville. Just to give you a little bit of background, I've been a resident of Monroeville for 16 years. For the past 9 of those years, I've been commuting up to the Butler Area School District, where I am an assistant principal with the school district. Being a member of the safety committee and having a lot to do with recent events that have even made national news with Butler, we do have armed guards in our buildings. My building is a 7th through 9th grade building, and we do have gentlemen. They do rotate through, so we do have guys that come through on a regular basis week to week, but we always have guys in the building. Our building is in lockdown at all times, so every door is locked except for one, and we do have a guard at the front. Along with that, that guard has access to a laptop, and we've had cameras put on every single door. So that those guys, not only are seeing the front entrance to the building and different views of the front entrance, but they see every entrance to our building. Try to make it as secure as possible. To go back a little bit, a few years ago, it was the Saturday after the Sandy Hook shooting, I received a phone call from one of our assistant superintendents who said that we're gonna go forth with our plan. A lot of people thought that the district had a knee-jerk reaction and armed our guards, because that Monday morning our guys were carrying, they were armed. And many people thought it was a knee-jerk reaction. It was not. That plan was in place from a year and a half before. The plan was for the following school year for our guys to be armed. It had been approved. It had been decided that was the route we were going to take. When Sandy Hook happened, the superintendent at the time made the phone call, got a hold of one of our judges. They opened up the courtroom that Saturday morning, and they gave the approval to arm our guys. Okay, for us, you know, it's a day in the life. Okay, when kids come to our school in the morning, there's 4 entrances they can come to, and we've done that purposefully so we can bring them through. We have them go through metal detectors. We check their bags, but one of the first things they see, no matter what entrance they go through, okay, they're going to see an armed guard. Okay, our guys aren't in full uniform as you would see, you know, one of the township guys or municipality guys. They're more of a soft uniform, but they are wearing their badge, gun is holstered on their hip, and they are wearing long white shirts and other khaki or dark pants. So they look like officers. They look like security officers. They're all retired state troopers. So these are guys that have spent 25 years or more of their life training and training some more in de-escalation and all the things, you know, that have benefited the public. We have those guys in our building. I've heard before, many people have asked me, well, is that intimidating for your students? Absolutely not. They're just as much a part of the building as I am when I'm walking around. They see these guys, they talk to them, they ask some questions. These guys develop a great rapport with the students of our buildings, even the elementary buildings. With some of the restructuring, some of the guys that were regular in my building are now down the elementary buildings. So elementary kids absolutely love them. Drawing them pictures, they're having their mothers bake cookies and whatever else, and they feel safe. Those kids feel safe, they feel secure. Oftentimes, I see when our kids are talking to our guards, they're shaking their hands, and I can't tell you how many times it has really pleased me to hear them say thank you for being here. Yeah, they're doing a job, absolutely. They're getting paid to be here. The goal of arming our guards was so that our teachers could teach and our students can learn without fear of anybody coming in to hurt them. It's that simple. If someone in the building had ill intentions, our guys will be there in about under 30 seconds. You've heard both these gentlemen speak before. Oftentimes, most of the damage is done in a very short amount of time, 5, 6, 7 minutes. Along the same lines, that's about the same time frame that any law enforcement responding, coming from outside the building, would take to get there. So having someone that can be there in about 30 seconds makes a whole lot of sense to me. I have three students in a district, all three of which went to Ramsey Elementary School. And when that incident happened, it's a scary thing. And my son was in the other kindergarten room. Pretty scary thing. Having our guys to be able to handle any kind of issues that come up makes a huge difference. I've personally had parents come in angry with me, decided they're bringing a buck knife on their pocket, on their belt. They don't want to hand it over. That puts me in a real bad situation. Fortunately, the guys there aren't going to let that happen. Students are as safe as they can be with people in the building. You know, schools are gun-free zones, so give me a break. If someone has ill intent, they're going to have, unfortunately, a shooting gallery. And that's been seen. One of the deputies at Columbine afterwards has said and has recommended numerous times, put armed guards in your school. And they're saying that for everybody. I understand the commitment that is. I understand the finances of that. But these gentlemen have already said, you can't measure what that does for a school. You cannot measure the help that it is. A few years ago, we had an active shooter training, and we went the whole nine yards. Coordination of all police or law enforcement agencies, EMS, 911, you name it. And we had gentlemen who came in. We had teachers that signed up. Some played students. Some played teachers. Went through the ALICE training, and we had guys come in, had an intruder come in. He was firing blanks. It was surreal. Even in my building, we've had numerous trainings so our teachers can hear firing off in different places of the building. Did you hear it? What did it sound like? Close your doors. Let's try to give you an idea so you can respond. The whole idea is to keep our kids safe. This is the best way to do that. The bottom line is, it's not a matter of if this is going to happen again. It's a matter of when. There are more shootings in schools across this country that you never hear about, which is a good thing. Maybe we won't have so many copycats. But the problem is, I think it has lulled us all into thinking that things are safe. It wasn't too long after 9/11, people thought, oh, we're safe again. We don't have to worry about terrorists. We all know that not to be true. It's no different with this. Throughout the days, like I said, our kids are always, they're there. They see our guys. It's a part of their culture, and they know they can trust those guys, and they know they're safe. You know, what more can I do? It's the first step for me. But as a board, what more can you do for your kids? You have to keep them safe. If you're not keeping them safe, well, then the rest of it's not going to make much of a difference. They have to be safe. You know, one of the things I thought about was we have armed guards everywhere. We have them at banks. We have them at airports. We have them at the mall. Why not schools? Tell me that there's anything in a mall or in a bank, an airport, that's more important than our kids. Nothing. So I'm in full support of it. Speaking on behalf of my wife, I know she is as well. But I think that would be the best thing for the district to do to help our kids. So if anybody has any questions for me, certainly, being in a school and dealing with it daily.
Thank you very much, Glenn. Last up in advance, Mr. Elms.
Robin Elms, 1303 Foxborough Drive. I read through this policy 709, and it made reference to school board, Pennsylvania school code policies. And I'd just like to point out that if you look at the school code, it does not give the officer in charge, well, first of all, you haven't defined who the officer in charge is. You need, I think you need some definitions on here to make it clear. If you have an SRO, it should be, definitely should be the SRO. If you, I mean, it has to be something like that. Furthermore, the school code does not give the officer in charge the ability to set up the requirements. That is defined by school code. It's, and you've got it listed in here. It's not, it's in 24 PS 778, but that refers back to 53 PA CSA, and that's the training requirements for an officer. So I think you really need to look at this and maybe clean up your legal requirements here. Now, as for what we just heard, I'm not at all against having armed officers, but I do want to point out, you know, I've been a school board for 4 years now, member, off the board. You have prevention and you have containment. What's being talked about right now is containment. I have no problem with containment, but you better look at the prevention as well. When they had the shooting down to Western Psych, there are multiple entrances to Western Psych. The first thing they did after that was made one entrance. Everybody's told you everything happens in the first few minutes. That's absolutely true. So what you want to do is slow people down. And that's where you've been looking at certain things. Slow the people down. Franklin Regional, that was a knife. An armed officer probably wouldn't have done a whole lot there. The kid is in the midst of hundreds of students. You can't start firing willy-nilly. That kid was taken down by an SRO. There was an SRO at Franklin Regional. He took him down physically. Also, he was, well, maybe not, they had somebody, but he was the one that actually contacted the police department, the Franklin, the regional police department. At least that's what I understand. I think what you need to be careful of is that you don't forget containment. That's an important part of protecting your kids. Thanks.
As for the legal things, we can look at that. If there was a misstated number, we apologize in advance for that. That's also with that one. Would anyone else like to address the board? Seeing none, we will move on to Section B, Bills and Financial Reports. Mr. Schott.
Section B, Section 1 lists the bills for the month of June 2016. Section B, 2 monthly financial statements for May 2016, and Section B, 3 budget transfers for June 2016 will all be finalized and presented at the June 21st, 2016 regular board meeting.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schott.
Thank you, sir.
Section C, we do not have any items previously tabled. We'll move on to Section D, personnel, and we will start with our action item agenda. Mr. Short.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Steubenbort. For action items tonight, resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors accepts and approves the personnel agenda items 1-5 as listed in Section D at the study session meeting on June 7, 2016. Item number 1 would be the employment of the Secretary of People Services. Item number 2, extended school year employment for a number of staff. Item number 3 is the early literacy program as well. And item number 4 would be the furloughs and transfers of professional staff. And item number 5, elimination of support staff for positions for the 16-17 school year for the reasons of economy.
Okay, this is, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any questions or comments?
I have a question. On, let's see what number this is. I'm just going to say teacher aides. Okay, they're showing 10 part-time teacher aides that they don't know what they're doing with. From what I understand, the other employees have been notified, being furloughed or, you know, positions eliminated.
Mm-hmm.
When or what do they plan on doing with the teacher aides?
Yep. I talked to Trish today, and it what they have to do is they have to find out which ones they are dependent on if they are in a certain classroom. So if they are an autistic aide versus
a regular ed aide.
So once they figure out which positions will be affected, then they will be notified.
Will that be done before next meeting, or will it carry over into July, which we have no meetings?
It should be carried over. I mean, yeah, we're going to try to, for everyone's sake, try to notify people as soon as possible.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions or comments?
I also have a question number five.
Yep.
I'm unsure as to how we can get rid of part-time teacher aides and still be in compliance with IEPs. Have the IEPs changed, or how do we remain in good standing with the need for the teacher aides?
Yeah, I can answer that one as well. Obviously, we have to follow IEPs.
Right.
That Heather had made sure that those were all being followed. Some of them are at recommendation of building administration. Some of them are at recommendation of individual teachers. We've also had several students graduate and move out of the district. We've had special placement from the district within this past year. So that is believed, obviously that number is fluid. You know, if we have a student come in from an outside district and they have an IEP and we evaluate that IEP, they need an aide, well then they're going to get that aide.
Right.
So yeah, we would make sure obviously all legal laws are followed.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes. I have a comment that I'd like to make publicly, and it deals with the employment section for Secretary of Pupil Services. I think most of the board members know where I stand in this issue. And I'm going to vote against this one particular element of it because I think it is wasteful of taxpayer dollars. I went on and did some research as to what the average pay for secretary was in the Pittsburgh Metropolitan District, and it was $25,000 a year, so well below the 38. My suggestion at a meeting previously was to start the position, and this is a non-union position, at $33,000. These are the kinds of issues that we have to, I believe, as a board, keep in mind as we move forward, because I think we're wasting taxpayer dollars. I think we're pushing out money that we don't need to push out. This is an attractive place to work. Our benefit package is second to none. When you put the benefit package on as a multiplier to this $38,000 a year, Trisha's not here, but my guess is it probably pushes the underbelly of $60,000 a year. I think that's exorbitant. I think taxpayers need to be aware that when we start making these kinds of decisions, you know, we're headed down the road of future tax increases. And while this is a small part of a larger budget, I understand that, it's the collective decision-making over a period of time on issues like this that puts us hundreds of thousands of dollars out of whack. And once you make these kinds of decisions, it's very, very difficult to pull back. So for that reason, on this vote, I'll take a no to item number one and I support the rest of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Bonnie, please.
Mrs. Sorokin.
Hi.
No? Yeah.
Hi.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
No on number one. Two through the balance aye.
Mr. Ritter.
John Ritter says aye.
Mr. Steubenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
No to number one and aye to the rest.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Byrne.
No to number one and aye for the rest.
All motions carried. Thank you very much. We will now move on to section D, personnel agenda, non-action item. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbort. We have for review tonight items number 1 through 6, resignations for the individuals listed below. Item number 2 would be leaves of absences. Item number 3 would be employment of substitute food service. We also have for item number 4 transfers of individual workers. Item number 5 would be the volunteers. And item number 6 would be the supplemental contracts that would be issued for the 16-17 school year.
Very good. Do we have any questions or comments on
any of that? I do, but I need to ask
one of these items, and I haven't found it here quickly, had a double asterisk. I don't recall the double asterisk is relative of a district employee. Let's see, depends where no. Indicates relative of a school board member or district employee. And I think one of them, am I wrong, had a three?
Yes.
Can you just bring me to those again, sort of quickly, and tell me who?
That was in the
previous.
Food services, tenant clearance, and documentation.
No, the one with threes.
There's none with threes under Section D.
On Section D, personnel action agenda.
The ones that were already voted on?
Yes. There were two names.
Okay, I'm sorry. I think I asked this earlier. Can the board be told, in, or shouldn't the board be told in advance who the relative is? And I don't know that that was done or has been done, and I've raised that before.
Yes, I am aware that you have raised that concern.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I would typically pass that over to our HR director, but she is not here.
Yeah.
I can make that known, and we will always note that in the future.
Okay, so we'll put it on the it right on the agenda. I mean,
including the asterisks with the actual name of the individual.
Okay, and then further, sometimes we have people who are, this is the third person, maybe even the fourth person in a family, extended family that we've hired. I think I'd like to know that as well. I think that occurred, and I voted in favor of it at the last voting session, but I think I'd like to know that as well going forward on many of the people that I'm not aware of. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Pass along to Trish. Thank
yeah.
you. Any other questions on non-action item Section D personnel agenda?
One question that I have.
Okay.
Supplemental contracts, is there mm-hmm. a limit to the amount of contracts that an individual person can have? Just out of curiosity.
No. There has never been an established limit, no.
Okay. If another question. With individuals having a lot of supplemental mm-hmm. contracts at this certain time of year, do they have enough time to devote to all the different...
meaning their teaching responsibilities?
Teaching responsibilities and all their other committees that they're on and the organizations that they're involved with.
Yes. The way the supplementals are handled, the individual building level administrator reviews the work of the individual that has the supplemental. So it is reviewed yearly. Recommendations are made to have that person again for the position the following year. So if there is a conflict, it would be noted by the building administrator.
Thank you.
One of the other issues that came up related to this a number of years ago, which I think might be useful for us as board members, is unless this has changed, Bill, oftentimes it's difficult finding people to fill the supplementals, and
absolutely
as a result,
correct, yes.
they end up picking up two or three. So it's that's a factor, I think, sometimes. Still
valid point.
Still,
yeah, still the
okay.
same.
Thank you.
Very good. Any other questions on personnel? Okay, we have one other item under Section D, personnel, and Mr. Shaw, if you could take that, please.
And again, this is an addendum item, again, not for action this evening, for discussion. And it's actually my pleasure to present this evening, is the appointment of the superintendent. Resolved that the Gateway Board of School Directors hereby appoints William Short to perform the duties of permanent superintendent effective July 1st, 2016, subject to the terms and conditions of the employment contract. Be it further resolved that the board president is directed to execute the contract with William Short.
Very good. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, we'll move on to Section E, administrative resolutions. Mr. Short.
Thank you, Mr. Steubenbord. For review tonight, we have items 1, 2, and 3, and I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Schott.
Sorry, these are yep. action items. I
yes.
apologize for that, Mr. Schott.
Resolution. Resolved that Gateway Board of School Directors approves and authorizes as appropriate the following items 1 through 3 as listed in Section E at the study session meeting of Tuesday, June 7th, 2016. Item number 1 specifically is the payment to Forbes Road Career and Technology Center, the estimate operating and administrative expenses for a 2015-2016 fiscal year in the amount of $887,671.80 as depicted in Exhibit A. And again, this payment allows them to pay off their revenue anticipation note for the 15-16 fiscal year.
Is this a question on this? Is this in line with our 15-16 budget number?
Actually, it's a little bit less than our 15-16 budget number. And what we've actually done, we've actually even reduced our 16-17 budget number to be reflective of the amount as well.
Okay, good, thanks.
Yep. Item number two, also related, is the Forbes Road Career and Technology Center revenue anticipation note for the 16-17 fiscal year in the amount of $4,400,000 as depicted in Exhibit B. And item number three.
Before we go.
Oh, sure.
I don't want to be the only one asking questions, but I'm not completely clear as to how the how our participation in a revenue anticipation note works. So maybe you could, unless I'm the only board member here who doesn't understand that, then he can speak to me privately.
No, I don't know either.
Okay.
No, I'll be more than happy.
Please.
All the various members, member school districts that participate in Forbes Road, since we also approve the budget, we also have to approve the revenue anticipation note. Since Forbes Road is not a taxing entity such as the district, they have no other means to receive funds to be able to operate their operations. So the revenue anticipation note allows them to receive the funds at the beginning of July to utilize those funds throughout the course of the year. And then as we're doing right now, we, the districts, make our contributions to enable them to pay off the revenue anticipation note. So that's what the first item is doing. We're paying off the 15-16 fiscal revenue anticipation note, and then we're also authorizing them to receive their 16-17 revenue anticipation note.
Okay, so it's an authorization. We're not actually participating in this $4,400,000 at this point. We will as we go through the year.
No, we authorize that. They receive the funds. They manage the funds on behalf of the students that we send over the Forbes Road.
Okay, gotcha. Thanks.
And actually, one item to even note related to the amount we're paying for 15-16, and even the note for 16-17, all the amounts are decreasing based on the decreased enrollment of students attending Forbes. So again, we're seeing our amounts that we have to pay decrease. The amount also decreased for the revenue anticipation note. 2 years ago, it was $4.9 million. Current year is $4.6 million. Now it's going to $4.4 million. So there's definitely a little bit of a trend there as well. Item number three is the annual approval of the district insurance coverage policy renewals for a 16-17 fiscal year, as depicted below. Again, all the various coverages. Overall, the net premium decreased by approximately 1%. So a little bit less for these various coverages for a 16-17 fiscal year.
This is an action. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion. We have a
second.
Motion and a second. Any questions or comments? Seeing none, roll call Barney, please.
Aye.
Mr. Nola.
Aye.
Mr. O'Donnell.
Aye.
Mr. Ritter.
Aye.
Mr. Stevenbort.
Aye.
Mrs. Warning.
Aye.
Mr. Williams.
Aye.
Mrs. Burnham.
Aye.
Mrs. Sirigi.
Aye.
Very good. Thank you, Bonnie. We will now move on to non-action item section E, administrative resolutions. Mr. Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Stevenbort. I will take items 1, 2, 3, and 4. Items number 5 through 16, I'll turn it over to Mr. Schott. These are up for review. We have new policy 709.2, the school police officers, and that's an Exhibit A. Also, we have item number 2, conferences and conventions. We have Mrs. Bungard and two special education teachers listed for conferences. Item number 3, we have the 30-day public display of new curriculum and textbook materials. There is an exhibit attached to the board packet as well. And item number 4 would be student teachers for the 16-17 school year. Mr. Schott.
Item number 5, administration will be seeking approval for various increases for student lunch and student breakfast prices for the cafeteria fund for the 16-17 fiscal year, specifically a 10-cent increase in lunches, 5-cent increase in breakfast prices. Again, this is in part of the district's compliance with Section 205 of the Healthy Hunger-Free Kids Act of 2010. Next item number 6 is the approval of the final cafeteria fund budget for the 16-17 fiscal year in the amount of $1,885,000, reflecting an increase of $111,000 or 6.26% more than the current cafeteria fund budget for a 15-16 fiscal year. Please note that the district will not be required to utilize any retained earnings, which is the cafeteria fund equivalent of fund balance, and the district will not be required to utilize any general fund contributions in order to balance the 16-17 fiscal year cafeteria fund budget.
To comply with the government regulations for healthy lunch, we have to increase our cost to our families to provide the lunch that they're mandating us to provide.
Yes, in addition to all the other healthy aspects and items that are associated with that. It's kind of a crazy item, but yes, unfortunately.
Paul, on item five, on the cafeteria prices, why is one middle school paying less than another middle school?
Well, those are the various rates that we've had traditionally, and the increases affect the current rates that are out there. So we have the elementary schools, for instance, which comprise the four buildings.
Mossad Middle School.
Still an elementary school. Yeah.
Grades five and six.
Yeah.
Yes. So they're kind of tied in, grouped in with K to four.
When you get up to the junior high, you get a little bit more portions.
Portion size.
They're not allowed to have any cookies or anything.
big cookies have been removed.
Michelle has one of them
like that.
Did they add a new shape to chicken patties?
If this board were moved to approve only a 4 cent increase as opposed to a 5 cent increase, would Paul be arrested by the federal government for that action? Maybe solicitor
Martin Lorenzo.
Food police. Somebody's going to have to pay.
I'm not
Michelle's term is
okay.
Up soon.
Paul.
And the next item is the final general fund budget for 16-17 fiscal year. And again, the amount listed, $71,341,000. Again, that is still a fluid number, but this is still the same number that was originally adopted as a proposed final budget in the month of May. This same number ties into the various documents the district is required to disclose on the website, and also the other additional documents, as well as we had the final public hearing last evening, again, with the budget. But again, in between now and June 21st, when the final adoption of the budget will take place, millage will be set. We are making changes to the budget. We're making increases, decreases to revenues, and also increases, decreases to expenditures. So again, that process will continue all the way up through June 21st. Based on additional information we're receiving, we're updating and reacting accordingly to that, so we can have the most accurate budget approved by the board on June 21st. But again, even as the budget sits and as we're making adjustments, the district, again, will not be required to utilize any fund balance and will not be required to initiate a tax increase for a 16-17 fiscal year budget. And just want to stress that. Next item is the annual approval of the homestead, farmstead exclusion, real estate tax assessment reduction for 2016. Based on the available gaming monies, I believe it's for the ninth year in a row the district is able to provide a homestead exclusion to those eligible properties located in the municipality of Monroeville and borough of Pitcairn for the 2016 calendar year. There are 8,197 properties which qualify, which means that each of those properties will see a decrease in their homes in their assessed value of $9,226.24. Which essentially nets out to a reduction in real estate taxes of $178.31. And again, this is revenue neutral to the district. The district does not benefit by any means in these amount of gaming funds that we receive. We merely pass it on to those eligible homesteads. Next item, administration will be seeking approval for the payment of Section B1 list of bills for month of July 2016. And again, since we don't have a board meeting scheduled for the month of July, this enables us to prepare the bill list and send it out. And as we've done in the past, when we prepare that list, we will send that out to the board, give you a week to review that, ask any questions prior to our physical mailing of those checks out to the various vendors. Next item is annual approval to be able to sell, give away, and or dispose as appropriate any old equipment, furniture, and various other miscellaneous items that are no longer serviceable to the district during the upcoming 16-17 fiscal year.
I have a question on that one. If we can provide a list, I know previously it's been listed, you know, 10-year-old Apple computers, whatever it might be. This is by far the most vague resolution we've seen on the agenda. So if whatever items they may be, if you could just notify the board.
We'll let the board know ahead of time. Thank you, Mr.
I don't want to see new iPads walking and saying,
kind of like a line item.
Yeah, if we could just have a list of items so we could at least say we gave it the go-ahead.
Year, age of item.
Yeah, doesn't have to be.
Yeah, we'll provide as much information prior to any disposals taking place. We'll let the board know that.
Okay.
Not a problem. Next item is actually a related item, an insurance item. It is the renewal of the current Better Unemployment Compensation Comprehensive Program through the Pennsylvania School Boards Association for the upcoming 16-17 fiscal year, as depicted in Exhibit C. Next item, administration will be seeking approval for the extension of the current liquid propane gas service agreements with Feral Gas. And again, this would just enable us to lock in a future price for the 17-18 fiscal year. We've done very well with this in the past. We were actually able to lock in a very low rate for our upcoming 16-17 fiscal year of $1.06 per gallon, which was down from our current 15-16 rate of $1.465 per gallon. And then luckily, assuming that's still out there and we're able to apply for the IRS fuel credit, take 50 cents off that amount. And so we have the potential to only pay 56 cents a gallon for liquid propane gas as compared to multiple dollars per gallon for diesel fuel. So again, we have some real potential to be able to for some significant savings. And depending on, again, where the commodities market is for liquid propane gas, we hope to be successful as well to lock in an additional year for 17-18. Next item, administration will be seeking the approval, some of the annual approval of our renewal of various software maintenance support and or license subscriptions with various vendors for the 16-17 fiscal year as depicted below. Again, these are just some of the items that we had available. There will be additional items added for both non-educational and educational software renewals for 16-17 fiscal year to the agenda of future board meetings to be approved by the board once renewal invoices and or agreements have been finalized between the various software vendors in the district. Next item, administration will be seeking approval for the IDEA Part B funds direct payment option agreement with the Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3 for the 16-17 fiscal year. And again, this is a slight change to what was previously approved at the April meeting in regards to the old IDEA Component 3 Consortium District Participation. Again, this enables us to provide a direct payment option for districts voluntarily purchasing any special education services through the AIU during the upcoming 16-17 fiscal year. As depicted in Exhibit E, it does not lock us into utilizing their services. If we decide to utilize their services, it's just a payment option we're able to utilize with the AIU. Next item, administration seeking approval for the rental contract with Mr. John for sanitation services for the upcoming 16-17 fiscal year, as depicted in Exhibit F. And next item, seeking approval for the renewal of the Waterfront Learning District Cyber School, with the Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3 for a 16-17 fiscal year, and that is depicted in Exhibit G. And the final item for this evening is a STEAM grant with the Allegheny Intermediate Unit 3 for a 16-17 fiscal year, and the amount of $20,000. And one other item, which we did not have ready for this evening, we were going to mention it in this week's weekly report. We spoke and worked with some folks from the Allegheny Intermediate Unit. Currently, if you recall, I believe it was back in April, we approved the extension of a lease for one classroom over Evergreen Elementary School. The AIU is interested, and we have the space, fortunately, to do this, and an additional classroom at Mossside Middle School, and additional classroom at Evergreen Elementary School. So again, we'll be utilizing the same per square foot rate utilized in the first classroom at Evergreen. We hope to have those items added to the agenda for the June 21st meeting. So again, we'll have some additional income coming in, rental income from the AIU to help offset some of our costs for a 16-17 fiscal year.
Thank you very much, Paul. Any other further questions or comments?
Yeah, I have one. On article 14, Mr. John. Where
do
we leave that, Mr. Johnson,
on here? Here on the campus. I believe that there's one or two of the pot.
Typically outside once the, if you want to call it the fall season, start right. For Monroeville football, junior program.
Junior high.
Junior high
for that aspect also.
And the summer as well, when you think, because we're, this is our first week of moving the three-day week, so our buildings are closed from Friday through Sunday, so if there's any activities occurring.
And that's not 12 months.
I would like to just close this in no relation of mine.
Any other questions or comments? All right. Seeing none, any resolutions presented by board members this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to comments from residents on non-agenda items. We have two who have signed up in advance. We'll start with Nancy Lapsovich. Nancy, if you could just say your name and address, please.
Nancy Lapsovich, 2497 Philbrook Road in Monroeville. Before I start, I'm going to digress a little bit. When I came into the heated argument of both councils that were here, I think it would have behooved them to stay and listen to the police officers and our friend from the Butler Schools. Knowing these people, and I'm going to the meetings, both Pitcairn and Monroeville, seeing, you know, their interactions with each other, I expected no less than to get into a heated discussion. And Mary Beth, I don't know if you saw my sign, go Mary Beth. If they can't control it, they don't want to hear about it. And it's not the kids that have the problem with any of this. It's the parents. It's the council, both. I'm talking about both Monroeville and Pitcairn. I applaud the school board from going forward. This isn't the high school, the class of 66 that I graduated from. And it's not the high school of what, 2005? Oh, God, I have socks older than him, that Chad graduated from. This is 2016. Focus is different. The country's different. We're living in one of the higher, and then I will get into my Narcan quest again, the highest drug area in the state, Western Pennsylvania. Granted, the killings, the shootings aren't coming in the schools for the drugs. These kids have their own agendas, but it's something that still has to be looked at as a problem. And I'm so glad you handled it so well. Thank you. And I know the safety committee's been on top of this for a long, long time, and you have to take credit for that. Now getting back to it, a few months ago I talked on Narcan, and I was looking for an explanation and a reasoning and an okay from the board. So I'm going to ask Mr. Steubenport. Chad, what do you got?
So I appreciate you following up. So what we had done, we reached out to SBA, PSBA.
From there, I've passed that along to who was in charge of the school nurses, Debbie Yelch, who has looked at it and made some recommendations to it. From there, before we even take it to the policy committee on the board, we actually need to get the school physician to sign off. So it'll actually go under his medical license. He would actually have to sign off on allowing, whether it be nurses, whether it be teachers, and that's really where the board would come into play to decide what, if any, would we allow within the schools. So right now, the physician, forget his first name, but it's Dr. Wolf through Forbes Regional, is reviewing and looking at any questions or comments he may have with the policy. From there, it would go to the policy committee mm-hmm. within the board, and then the board as a whole would decide, you know, do we want our nurses to have this in the schools? Do we want to allow teachers to have this in the schools? So there's a few different options available, and a lot of different schools are each really doing their own different thing. I would also like to add, so like I said, the governor has passed, or legislation has been passed where the first dose would be provided free to the schools. Once that expires, the schools would then be responsible for paying for that.
Narcan has a shelf life of 2 to 3 years, and I've actually reached out and started conversations with the CEO over at Forbes. We utilize Narcan on the ambulance quite frequently, unfortunately. And what I'm proposing, and I think they would be on board with it, is they would actually give us the drug for free, and then after a year, we would switch out that drug. So they still have a year or two to utilize that drug, which, trust me, the ambulance services around here would be utilized, and then they would just give us a newer batch of the Narcan. So that way there would be no cost associated to the district. Also, the training would be free. I've talked with Dan Schwartz, who is the emergency physician who runs the EMS in the area, and he said he personally would provide it, or he could also provide paramedics, even within Monroeville, who use it really on a, I hate to say daily, but on a weekly and definitely on a monthly basis, and actually train the nurses, train the teachers, whoever we would want to have trained, and that would all be free. So we're looking at no cost to the district. We just have to figure out a few nuances with the physician, and once we get his remarks back, we will take it to the board, and we will definitely keep you updated from there.
Okay, thank you. I know that it's now over the counter. You can go to the Giant and get a supply in of Narcan. God forbid you don't want it or don't need it. But there again, I'm feeling that the Narcan is going along with the armed guards is prevention. It's a prophylactic. It's like a birth control pill. It's like that other word for prophylactic. I think those two together have to be something that I would like to see by the beginning of the school year. I know there's a lot of background work, but I'll be back.
Sounds good. We look forward to it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Nancy.
Thank you, Arnold.
Arnold?
So what's tonight?
We have one.
I'll be back.
One more resident who had signed up in advance, Mr. Elms, on another item.
Robert Elms, 1303 Foxborough Drive. I'd just like to read a piece of reference material. Back March 25th, 2010, the school district was out looking for a new superintendent. And Albert Noose, who was at the time an excellent professor down at Pitt, wrote a little article in the newspaper, and part of it listed the characteristics of school leadership that we need to look for in Gateway. One, clear vision or hunger to see improvement. Two, a high priority value for student learning and communications with total community. Three, a high value of teacher administration and community input in school operations and decisions. Four, a leader of change through communications and listening to all people in the entire community. Five, a proactive risk taker when it comes to the educational reform and policy enforcement. You have a new superintendent. He has these capabilities. Without the board's support, nothing will get accomplished. I would encourage this board to support you. Somebody who has a proactive risk taker is going to come back with things that are quite possibly may cost money. But change is something nobody's going to like, but you're going to have to support it. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr.
Holmes.
Anyone else in the public like to address the board on any items? Seeing none, we will move on to reports. Mr. Shaw, do you have anything for this evening?
Nothing further.
Very good, Mr.
Something real quick. Last week, a little nervous energy in the air, literally, graduation. It went off very well. I wanted to thank the high school administration. Mr. Narsboro, who read the 300 names, did a fantastic job. And, you know, it's the culminating activity. It's why we're here, to acknowledge those graduates. And I was so proud of each and every one of them to have their moment walking on stage outside instead of inside. So, and I thank the board for their participation as well. That's it.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to board reports. Scotty?
I'd like to thank Mr. Stoffinus and Team Slambot for the gifts tonight, and also congratulate them again on a job well done, and for representing Gateway. Hats off to you and everybody involved. And also congratulations to all the graduates. And I'd also like to thank Monroeville and Pitcairn for showing up this evening and look forward to working with them in the future. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Scotty. Mr. Ritter.
Well, my mind is full. How about if I save my reports for another time? Okay.
Very good. We have a meeting in 2 weeks.
Yep.
Mary Beth.
Okay, I think the intergovernmental meeting was not televised, right?
Unfortunately, it was not.
Okay. So that's a good thing. So the general public might like a brief update on where we are with security and what happened at the intergovernmental meeting. And basically, we had asked Monroeville two questions. If they could participate in our school security by A, exercising the Home Rule Charter and hiring a Monroeville part-time police force for the school, if that was an option or not, or two, if they could reduce the cost of our current Monroeville SRO, either just to make up the difference of about $20,000 to help us stay within our budget, or possibly reduce Officer Kandrak to a 181-day schedule rather than the 365-day schedule that he is currently on, and that would get him in line with Officer Morency, who also spends 3 months of the year back on the streets in Pitcairn. We didn't get to discuss further the possible benefits of Monroeville community, knowing that we might be a little bit short-staffed of police officers and short-staffed of supervisors. Maybe that would be a win-win for both the community of Monroeville and the school district of Gateway. And as I said in the intergovernmental meeting, I wanted to dispel any rumors that we did not want to keep Officer Morency or Officer Kandrak. Our number one goal that we, if we could have it, would be to retain both of those SROs in addition to hiring an armed security staff for elementary schools and to replace our unarmed staff with those armed guards. So we will anxiously await and hope that we can work together with the communities both of Pitcairn and Monroeville to make our schools safer for our students, which is my first priority, and for our faculty, and to remember moving forward that, as Mr. Elm said, change is difficult, but sometimes it is necessary. And our goal and the security staff here at Gateway, and I think I speak for the board and the faculty, is to look out for the best interests of our students. They are irreplaceable. They are the most valuable asset that we have, and I want to do everything we can in our power to protect them. And if you have any questions at all on the costs, on the plan, if you'd like more details, please reach out to me via email, via phone. I also do have a Facebook page. It is Mary Beth Cerucci, Gateway School Board. You can find me there as well. And I am very impressed and happy with Mr. Stakunis and his team of young men. You have made Gateway very proud, and that is the Gateway that I know. And that is where the term Gateway Pride comes from. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mary Beth. Mrs. Waring.
A couple things. Mr. Stockholmus, thank you for putting in so much time and effort with these students. Your work has paid off, and it shows with these fine students that you have in your robotics group. Congratulations also for their awards that they're doing. Thank you to also the Monroeville and Pitcairn Council police officers that did show up, our mayors, for the intergovernmental meeting. We're here, the committee is here for one reason, is to keep our students and staff safe here at Gateway in all our schools. And that's what we're looking to do. So all the inputs that we get, all the information that we get, that's our main goal. So hopefully there's no hard feelings, whatever, we're working towards the same goal. Hopefully that everyone has is just the safety of our schools. Graduation. I was sitting on a field, names were being called, and it brought me back 14 years ago when I was working over at University Park. I saw 25 of these young students coming in, wide-eyed kindergarten students. Oh my gosh, holding onto their parents' legs, you know, crying. We have to start school. And last week I watched 25 of these same students walk across the stage getting their diplomas. Not that the time went that fast, but it just showed how much Gateway has helped these students grow.
classes, teachers, everything that they have gotten through Gateway. It was like a blink of an eye to me. One of the little girls could not speak any English when she came. Just amazed me because everybody was so worried about her. What a beautiful young lady that she has turned out. So congratulations to all 301, I believe, students that graduated. You are fine young ladies and young men. And on a happy note, teachers, 78 days to be back in the classroom, and students, 82 days. So enjoy your summer, and that's all for this evening.
Thank you, Val. Mr. Lapsovich.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good evening. A few closing remarks. First of all, I'd like to give a hand to Bonnie Eshaw, our transportation director. She has saved the district close to $300,000 with bus service. Great job. Then on Thursday, I had the honor to sit at a graduation as a new school board member. I was so proud to be there. I'm more proud of our graduating students. It was a tough year for all of us, but I think we all got through it stronger and more united. But looking into the capacity field stadium at the beaming graduates, I saw pride for our school on everyone's faces. That night, I saw two colors that holds us together, black and gold. Congratulations again to our school, our parents, our staff, and most of all, our graduates. And thank you, Matt, for being an outstanding teacher. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Ben?
I would also like to say thank you to Matt Stefanis and his Slam Ball team. I really appreciated getting to see the Slam Bot over the last few months, and it's really exciting to see us go to a national competition and do so well. Also, congratulations to the 2016 graduates. I'm sure you will make us proud. And I'd also like to wish a happy and safe summer to all of the students. And thank you to Monroeville and Pitcairn Council for the intergovernmental meeting today. And that's all.
Matt, good job. Good job to your students. You brought the standing cup home. That's great. It's pretty significant. Congratulations to our graduating class. And wish them the best, and that's all. Thank you.
No, I'm not sure that's procedurally.
So I'll be really brief.
Mr. Solicitor.
So I was on the phone, the bus ride back from Harrisburg, and I heard some really great stuff that should be on a big plaque outside some of the doors to the school. The bottom line regarding armed guards in our schools is
the kids feel safe. Gateway, the kids feel safe. Wow. The armed guards are there so that our teachers can teach and our students can learn. That's really quite succinct. As a board, your goal is to keep your students safe. If they're not safe, nothing else matters. So at Franklin Regional, I've got 42 nephews and nieces. And when there was a stabbing there a couple years ago, I quickly got on the text and I said to my brother, is such and such, is the boy safe? And I got a text back that no uncle should ever get. He's safe, he ran. I was glad. Some of the other students, they weren't able to run and they got hurt. So what we're doing here, Mary Beth, thank you very much for bringing, safety to our schools. All right, so I was out in Harrisburg. There's another aspect of safety, House Bill 1948 that's being deliberated right now. It's regarding students who are very, very small and in their mother's belly. We're trying to keep them safe through this legislation so that they won't be hurt before they're born. So that's why I was there. I also met with PSBA legal, what's his name? It'll come to me in a second, that's the way my brain works. But I talked to him, John Callahan, and I talked to him about our goal to be able to measure the board's performance. He also said that's a good idea. So everybody I talked to about this seems to think it's a good idea. He recommended that the policies that PSBA has already lined out might be a good first step. So the first step of defining yourself as being a good board would be, have you followed the policies laid out by PSBA? I said, okay, that's a good first step, but there needs to be others that are measured in a neutral third-party manner. So this is, I want to hold our feet to the fire. When I was elected knocking on doors, I promised people that we would allow ourselves to be held responsible for what we do in a neutral way, so that when there's turmoil, politics aren't involved, but it's data-driven. Personalities are taken out of the picture, and we either do what's right for the kids or we don't do what's right for the kids, and it's neutral. Take the personalities out of it. That's one of the ways to do it, to lead egolessly. Take your ego out, do what's right, whether you like it or not, whether people don't like it or not, do it. It's the right thing to do. That's how we can keep our kids safe. That's how we can graduate more and more kids. That's how we can attract businesses to come into a place that's safe, drug-free, reduced crime, a place where people enjoy paying their taxes because they want to be part of a community that is a good place to live and grow and send your kids to and grow old in. So that's my report.
Thank you very much, John. Mr. Nola.
I'd like to congratulate Team SlamBot. Congratulations. That's just an unbelievable and great accomplishment. I'd like to thank the administration and the board for all the time and energy and enthusiasm that's put in. And everybody here, I mean, I think we have a little bit of a, you know, different backgrounds and different things, the administrators and everybody. But I think that we work together very well, and I think that we come to solutions very well. And I know that everybody puts in countless hours and time, and I just appreciate everybody's work. And I just want to say thanks to all of us and all the other administrators. Thanks. That's it.
Thank you, Neil. I have a few things to go over. I guess first, when people ask me, why the heck are you on school board? Such a thankless job, put in all that time, work, effort. You don't get paid anything. I think there's two things that really kind of speak to that happened this past week. So the one being graduation. Great ceremony. A little bit of thunder scared us there. But great ceremony that we had 301 students graduate from. Another one is, we had a team of four go out to LSU and placed third out of 75. And that's not just teams from America. That was internationally. That's pretty big story there. That's awesome. So, Mr. Salkunas, thank you to you and to the four students who are able to achieve that. So that's, I guess, really why I do it when we see that. A few other things to touch on. For security, I know we've said it a bunch of times, but thank you, Mary Beth, Steve, and George, who are all part of the safety committee, for actually bringing this to fruition. As we saw in our intergovernmental, or as you guys did not see, but anyone who was here who saw the intergovernmental meeting, it can be heated. We're not always going to be popular. We're going to make some people mad. But, John alluded to a good point, and several of us have. We have to worry about the safety and the welfare of our students, our staff, and our teachers at the Gateway School District. I think the safety committee has done an outstanding job. If I hear one more person say, oh, you rushed into... Well, that's not true. I wish you could see how many hours they've done walkthroughs, how many times they've gone off to Butler, sat down with individuals, saw what was successful, what was not successful, really all of the time and effort that went into this before this was actually even proposed to the board. So to you three, thank you very much. To Monroe and Pitcairn, thanks for showing up. It's a lovely meeting. Hopefully we'll be able to get a response within a few weeks, hopefully less time than we have for the delinquent tax plan. And again, I really hope they keep in mind that this is for the safety and the concerns of the teachers, the staff, and the students. Take politics out of this, take who you hate, who you love out of this, and really focus on what this is all about. If you think it's a horrible idea, that's fine, let us know. We've heard a few comments out there, we talked to every teacher and they're against it. I would like to find some of those because I haven't yet. So anyone who is for or against it, please feel free to reach out to me. I know when WTAE did that story, there was a poll online. 75% of the public said they were in favor of having armed guards at every school. I know that Bo had interviewed a lot of people outside of the auditorium that day and couldn't find one person opposed to it. So if anyone is opposed, please speak up. Anyone in favor, please speak up. Email the board. Let us know your thoughts moving forward. But again, thank you for the tremendous work of the safety committee. As for the budget, amazing job by everyone. You know, we're currently looking at a balanced budget with no tax increase and no fund utilization, none of the general fund utilization. That's awesome. That hasn't happened in over a decade. We are still looking at the budget. There's still things to be decided, but I'm very, very confident that we will have a balanced budget with no utilization of the general fund, which is very, very good. I guess one other shout out I wanted to give was to Mr. Lassick, who was my choir teacher at high school, and he was there for the graduation, but just for making us learn the alma mater, so I was able to sing along to that the past 2 years. Thank you for that, Mr. Lassick. And I will end with saying, go Pens. We have a game on Thursday. We have an opportunity to win the Stanley Cup for the first time ever in Pittsburgh to actually host the Cup. So hopefully we can hoist that. So thank you very much, everyone. We'll see you guys in 2 weeks. We have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion, second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Seeing one, motion, or meeting adjourned.
Before you turn off, here it is.
Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you.
I'm going to go to Eaton Park because I'm looking for a piece of pie.